Hello, and don't clap for me. Hello, and welcome to tonight's lecture at Fermilab. Before I introduce the speaker, I want to remind you to please turn off and silence all of your electronic devices. But I also want to let you know about our upcoming art shows and lectures. On May 10th, we will be presenting Circo Commedia. This is a family-friendly show, and it will start at a special time of 7 o'clock in the evening. This show presents unpredictable thrills, side-splitting comedy, and daredevil stunts, which are the signature of Circo Commedia, starring the fantastic duo from Montreal, performing their distinctive style of humor, acrobatic tricks, daring feats, magic, and eccentricity. Remember, that's Saturday, May 10 at 7 p.m. Also on a special day and time, on Wednesday, June 11th, we will have a special lecture here at Fermilab that's part of the users meeting that we have here annually. This lecture is by Dr. Hitoshi Murayama, and it's on the quantum universe. He'll be speaking about the most fundamental question in science: what is the very beginning of the universe? And finally, on August 15th, we'll kick off our next lecture season, where we'll have a lecture by Dr. Deandra Leslie Pilecki, author of The Physics of NASCAR and a blog called Building Speed. The subject of her talk is The Science of Speed: Why Driving Fast is Harder Than You Think. With that, it's my great pleasure to introduce you tonight to our speaker, Dr. Nigel Lockyer.
Is that it?
No, I've got more. Dr. Lockyer began his tenure as the director of Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory this past September. As an experimental particle physicist, he spent more than two decades as a professor at the University of Pennsylvania. His research focused on the high-energy particle physics using experiments at our own Tevatron here at Fermilab, and also the applications of particle physics technologies to medicine. In 2005, he became the director of TRIOMPH, Canada's National Laboratory for Nuclear and Particle Physics, and under his leadership, TRIOMPH formulated a vision for ascending the world stage in nuclear physics, expanded its operations by 25%, developed strong partnership among Canada's major science laboratories, and launched new international collaborations. Dr. Lockyer holds a PhD in physics from The Ohio State University, is a fellow of the American Physical Society, and received that society's 2006 Panofsky Prize for his leading research on the bottom quark. So now, please join me in welcoming Dr. Lockyer.
Okay, hope you're ready. So the title was intended to be provocative. It wasn't quite what I planned. If any of you followed it closely, it was actually a previous title, and so we ended up with something which I expect the front row to be paying attention when sticks show up, stones show up, batteries show up, just so that I cover all topics. All right, so I know you're a sophisticated audience, so there's really just one message. Curiosity leads to questions, which lead to the development of new tools to answer the questions, and tools have benefits. So it's going to be questions. Questions need to be answered, so you develop tools to answer them, and then those tools have benefits, and then the cycle repeats itself. So that's what I'm saying here. And by the way, sticks, stones, and particles are all tools, as you will see. All right, so I thought I'd start out a little bit and say something about Canada, because it is a US audience, just in case you don't know. And then before that, you heard I was from the University of Pennsylvania, so Ben Franklin was the founder, so I am supposedly a scholar in Ben Franklin. Not true. I read a couple books. And then I'll talk about particles as tools. I'm going to talk about niobium, and then some massive history with quarks and neutrinos, the Higgs, just the beginning, and then neutrinos and mass. So these famous people here, you know who this is? Front row? They're all looking at each other now. Okay, so this is Isaac Newton, Ben Franklin, What's the word that comes after Higgs? All right, bison. No, boson, that's right. That's a Fermilab joke, if you didn't know. And that's Mr. Higgs himself. All right, so this is a map of Canada as seen from the United States. I'm glad you laughed. I was expecting silence, you know. That, what's so funny about it? For the younger people, Canada is up here. You know, I look at the weather map every night, and this is what I see. I think, well, okay. So there's a map of Canada for you, just in case you didn't know. It's the second largest land area of a country in the world, has the ninth largest GDP, and therefore it's part of the G8. Figure that out. And then the population is basically California, 30, 35 million people. And as you know, everybody lives along the border within a couple of feet. All right. This is where I come from, Vancouver. And so you're saying, yes, why did he come here? You know, that's interesting. So living in a nice forest preserve, this is where the X-Files was filmed, if you wanted, right behind the laboratory. There's some water. And that's where the skiing takes place. So that was a nice location. Okay, Canadian cuisine, it works at Fermilab. Donuts, lousy coffee, and fish in the main injector, I guess, is where they come from. All right, other attributes of Canada. So you may recognize Hillary Clinton here explaining to this young lady, is this my clean energy future? There's the border, US, Canada. This is the Prime Minister of Canada carrying the world's dirtiest oil. That's what it looks like. Looks great. Second largest reserves of oil sands. Now, if you say oil sands, you're in the equivalent of US parlance, you're a Republican. And Canada, you're a conservative. And if you say tar sands, then you're a Democrat or you're a liberal. So I won't tell you which of those I use on a regular basis. Lots of oil. This says you can't squeeze blood from a turnip, but you can squeeze one barrel of oil from every 4 tons of Mother Earth. And so that's the whole story with the Canadian tar sands, the most destructive project on Earth. Needless to say, since I came from Western Canada, we did not support this. And so that got us into a lot of trouble. Canada and the U.S. has a special relationship. Canada is the number one supplier of energy to the U.S., 3 million barrels of oil per day to the U.S. Interestingly, Illinois is the largest trading partner with Canada of any of the 50 states, which I was surprised to find that, $60 billion. And 950,000 Canadians visited Fermilab in 2012. All right, there's just some more statistics for you, you know. Europe doesn't exist. Now, did I mention the Olympics? You know who this is. This didn't last. And, oh yeah, that happened again. I forgot about that. So that was very good. All right, so I now want to begin talking about Canada's, Philadelphia's most famous icon. Okay, so, no, it's not Ben Franklin. That's someone else. Maybe in his younger days. Okay, so Ben Franklin, statesman, politician, founding father, printer, inventor, swimmer, businessman, writer, but most importantly, which I'm going to emphasize tonight, he was a super accomplished scientist, and that's really the message. This is the period he lived, basically the 1700s. He almost spanned the entire century. And he's perhaps the leading theoretical and experimental physicist of the Age of Reason. So curiosity drove his research. Franklin actually quit his job when he was 42 and retired. So that sounds pretty good. Spent all of his time doing experiments in electricity, about 10 years. No prospect of anything useful coming out of his work. He was just driven by what he wanted to do was have fun. So that's a message for you. So let's talk about the first lightning experiment. So here's the proposal as it stands. So you build this little box, you stand inside of it on a metal plate, and you take this rod, and it's a very tall rod, into the sky with a sharp point on the end. and you stand inside of it, and Franklin says, I don't think there's any problem with doing this, but if you're lucky, when the storm comes over, you will notice something. And sure enough, okay, so Franklin was nearly killed by his early experiments with lightning. So let's just read the blue here. Unusual blow throughout my whole body from head to foot, after which the first thing I took notice of was a violent, quick shaking of my body, which gradually remitting my senses as gradually returned. Now, this guy was not as successful. So these are the early days of electricity. All right, so you know about Franklin's kite experiment. There's actually a debate whether it ever took place, but we'll just assume that it did because that's the way history works. So it is dangerous. Art may be good to look at, but it's not always accurate. First of all, this does not look like Ben Franklin, and furthermore, he was much younger when he did his kite experiment. And as I like to say, I doubt very much these people were involved in the early experiment. All right. The other one is, which he's famous for, is he tried to kill a turkey with static electricity. Now, for those of you who don't know, when you drag your socks across the floor in the winter, across the carpet, you charge up, you touch the doorknob, you get a little shock. That's static electricity. So you can read about Franklin building this, which is actually the first battery. Did I say the word battery? So Franklin is given credit for this. He also, interestingly, these Leyden jars, he spent quite a bit of time trying to understand how they worked, and he published a paper on how they work. So he was an experimental physicist, and he was very systematic in the way he went about trying to understand things. So he was pioneering in many respects. All right, so shocking parlor fun all over Europe, but also in the United States. So this was popular with young Quakers in Philadelphia. So the men and women were not allowed to enter the same door in those days. So the men came in one door, the women came in the other door, and then they would meet in the middle, and then they would hang somebody from some ropes. And this is a electrostatic generator. You see the foot's connected here. So you charge up this person. This is quite strange, isn't it? And then this guy comes over with what looks like a little wand, and then there's a spark, and then that was the entertainment for the evening. I won't go into further things that went on there, but it was interesting. All right, so laboratory accomplishments in electricity. So the single fluid theory of electricity, which is valid today, is from Franklin. So people used to think of it as electric fire. It was just created, but he understood that it actually traveled from one place to another. He's known for assigning plus or minus charges. The idea of conservation of charge, which is a very modern idea, is attributed to him. This is the idea that led to the lightning rod, geometrical distribution of charges, having a point versus a rounded surface. He understood how the Leyden jar worked, which I showed you in the previous page. Actually, he didn't quite understand it correctly, but it was a very subtle thing that he didn't quite get right. He coined the term battery. He built the first parallel plate capacitor. He distinguished between conductors and insulators. He understood the concept of induced charge, and he understood electrical grounding. So this is my house at Fermilab. That's the roof. And for those of you who don't know, that's a lightning rod, right? So that, if the lightning comes down, rather than striking me in the head, it's supposed to hit this, and then it travels down to the ground, and I'm safe. So a lot of houses have these. I don't know. How many people have lightning rods in their house here? I guess one. Plus, that's why you don't know what it is. Okay. All right, this was a bestseller in Europe. It's called Experiments and Observations on Electricity, made at Philadelphia in America by Mr. Benjamin Franklin and friends. So Europeans recognized Franklin first and foremost as a scientist. His gifts as a writer made him one of the most readable and understandable scientific writers of the time. Louis XV was fascinated by his writing and orders his experiments to be performed in his presence. So Franklin was a serious scientist. He was recognized as the leading electrician in Europe. They called him electricians because he was studying electricity before his role as a statesman. He had a number of prestigious awards from various places. Interestingly, the English and the French at that time was an important thing for him. So Franklin is actually compared with Newton and Einstein. So you notice Newton is 1642, 1727, so he did overlap a little bit with Franklin. So Franklin would have been, 20 or so when Newton died. And then the point is that during that period, the 1700s, he was the world-famous scientist. He was the Newton of his time and the Einstein of his time. And because Franklin did so much, we tend to think of him more as a statesman, but he was a great scientist. So here's something about him being a statesman, and I just learned this recently myself. So we hold these truths to be self-evident. You recognize this as a Declaration of Independence. Franklin's edit to the assertion of religion in Thomas Jefferson's original wording. So Jefferson was signed up to draft the Declaration of Independence, and there was just a slight adjustment by the master. At that time, Franklin was the master. Everybody listened to him. He was the sage. And he rearranged this so that rather than saying this, he was going to say self-evident. So that's the word self-evident comes from Franklin himself. The scientific mind of Franklin drew on the scientific determinism of Isaac Newton and the analytic empiricism of Hume and Leibniz. In what became known as Hume's fork, the latter's theory distinguished between synthetic truths that describe matters of fact and analytic truths that are self-evident by virtue of reason and definition. So the scientific side of Franklin came out with his reasons and definitions there. So that was, I think that's quite significant to the country as a whole. So science is characterized by questions. Franklin made various tools to study what drove his curiosity. The kite is the most famous. He was a true experimental physicist, and I'm going to say we do the same thing today. Okay, so remarkably, 99% same genome. Chimps use sticks, second word in my title, as tools for discovery to reach inside accessible holes. So when I made this, I had just seen something that said a chimpanzee can pick up a stick and walk half a mile to use it to find some bugs in a tree. So it's not like it's at the tree and it's looking around how to do it, but actually thinks about it and then walks a long way and then does something with it. So it's quite a, predetermined thought and exercise that the chimp goes through. Here's another stick. It's a pencil, and it's very effective with a young Einstein in this picture. Now we get a little more sophisticated with the cloud chamber. So this is a particle physics detector. It's a tool to see particles. Charles Wilson discovered the cloud chamber, was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1927, and this was something, he was pursuing something that interested him, which was called the Brocken spectra on Ben Nevis, which is a mountain in Scotland in 1894. And the positron was discovered by Carl Anderson using the cloud chamber in 1932. So the ideas that came here came from Wilson trying to understand, if you go to the top of the mountain, it was known that you could see sort of your shape on the clouds, and you were very big, and people did not quite understand it, but there's numerous optical illusions that come about. And while he was up there, he had the idea for the cloud chamber. The muon was also discovered in 1936 using the cloud chamber in cosmic rays, and I'm not going to go into it, but that is a tool that's used in material science studies today. Now, Ben Nevis is more than a mountain with cosmic rays. Here, for those of you who like to tour Scotland, you do know what that is, right? That's a refreshment, and there's... All right, I have to help you out in some cases. Scientists are always looking for practical solutions. So here's a cosmic ray striking the upper atmosphere, making all these particles coming down. And this is a very famous physicist, Millikan, saying cosmic rays may forecast the weather. So cosmic rays may help to prophesy the weather. Strange English in those days, but so the first practical use of mysterious radiations from outer space was recently announced, blah, 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 California Institute of Technology. So you know it had to be right because it came from a great institution. So antimatter now exists in my talk. It is now a tool. So nuclear medicine doctors use positrons, which are anti-electrons, to image inside the body. Using PET scanners, as they're called, positron emission tomography. The anti-electron annihilates, and the detector is used to detect the gamma rays. That's basically a fancy cloud chamber. So now, once you've built one detector to detect particles, you start to make them more and more sophisticated. So detectors are tools, and so is antimatter in this case. All right, so antimatter is everywhere. Our bodies emit about 400 positrons per second. Anti-electrons. Bananas, for example, contain potassium. Potassium-40 has a half-life of 1.25 billion years. It's used for dating, but nevertheless, it does decay. We ingest it when we eat bananas. And one avocado, by the way, is equivalent to two bananas in terms of its radioactivity. So just not too many avocados, please. All right, so I'm going to give you an example of where positrons are used. This is related to work we did at Triumph, but I thought you would be interested in it. So it's about Parkinson's disease. It's studied with antimatter. So Parkinson's is a chronic neurological disorder resulting in a lack of control over movement, results in poor balance and coordination. Parkinson's disease is caused by the death of dopaminergic neurons in the brain, and I acknowledge my two colleagues there. So dopamine is a neurotransmitter that impacts your movement, it impacts your motivation, it impacts addiction, and it impacts reward and well-being. This slide is from Nora Volkow, who is a very famous person for studying this effect. So let's say probing the dopamine system. So this is a neuron. This whole thing is a neuron. The gap, as you may know, is called the synapse. So what happens is, the body eventually takes these chemicals, in this case L-DOPA, and converts it into dopamine and stores it in these little vesicles. And in order for this neuron to fire, you have to take these empty out these vesicles, travel across the synapse, and connect to these dopamine receptors. And there's five different types of receptors, but we'll just say one type for simplicity here. Then the neuron fires. This DAT, as it's called, is the dopamine transporter. So once the dopamine's on this receptor, it has to come back and get stored again. So it's a negative feedback loop for those who understand what that means. So when it comes across, it turns on the cell, and when the dopamine comes back, it turns off the cell. Now all of these various molecules you see here are used. They're first of all, they're tagged with a radioactive isotope. In this case, it's F-18. And in some other cases here, it's carbon-11. But in all cases, it's a positron that's emitted from this molecule, so you know where it is. And to make a long story short, we're able to measure how much dopamine you've actually made. We're able to see how much actually comes across and gets received. And you can see how much comes back. So all these different tracers break down the various stages of the neuron. Observing the placebo effect. So you've all heard of the placebo effect, presumably. It's the idea that you take something and it's really just a sugar pill and you feel better because you took it. This is the first, on the bottom here, first demonstration of the neurochemical effect of the placebo. So in other words, the act of receiving any treatment may in itself make you feel better. So what you're looking at is a PET scan with something called raclopride, which some of you may know what that is, labeled with C11, and it emits positrons. And you're looking at this red region here and comparing it to the red region here. And what happens in a patient with Parkinson's is that they're giving the placebo, and in this case, they thought they were receiving their medicine, which reduced the symptoms, which is possible in the early stages. And what was observed is that these patients who have lost the ability to make dopamine in the brain were able to make it. So in other words, you think you've lost the ability to make it, but in fact, under certain conditions, your body was able to figure out how to make it. And so this is a very famous piece of work here. Okay, so it gets more interesting. So this is the kind of thing you can go home and have a discussion about, because it's interesting. So the expectation may affect placebo response in Parkinson's patients. The study uses PET scans. So let's imagine the first day the patient receives the levodopa. That's the medicine, which leads to dopamine production in the brain. The second day, the patients are told they either have a 25%, 50%, 75%, or 100% chance of having received levodopa, but they all receive the placebo. So remember on the previous page, I told you that the placebo had an effect that allowed people who don't normally make dopamine in their brain to be able to make it. Only the 75% chance group released dopamine. So it's not good enough to give somebody a placebo, and if it's 25% chance that it is the real medicine, then that's not good enough, and they don't make the dopamine. And if it's 100%, that's too good, and they still don't make it. So there has to be a desire by the person, whatever that means. There has to be some reason to want this to work, that it actually works. So this was a thesis of Sarah Lidstone, and very interesting. Here's a interesting statistic. Pathological gambling behavior has been diagnosed 2 to 8 times more frequently amongst Parkinson's patients who take these type of medicines than the general population. And gambling addiction is classified as a mental illness in the UK. So all of these things make you think about, well, geez, how does medicine really work, and how is your brain really working? But my main point is this is being studied in great detail using positrons. Okay, so now let's talk about stones. So this is a very nice looking stone. So I've now covered stones, front row, right? Very good. All right, and this is niobium, which is formerly known as Colombian, and you're going to see where does it come from? Sharp audience, very good. Actually, most of it comes from Brazil, and if I was very precise about Canada, it comes from Quebec, which is not quite Canada, but okay. All right. That would get me into a lot of trouble in Canada. All right, so in 1992 alone, niobium titanium wires were used to construct more than $1 billion worth of clinical magnetic resonance imaging systems. So as you know, the Tevatron was built out of superconducting magnets. The magnets have this type of wire in it. And then after building such a big machine, then industry was able to go out and make MRIs. This is kind of an old MRI, but they still make them. And it's niobium's a big part of that story. So here's a little history. So a rock sample was sent to the British Museum in London from Massachusetts in 1734. So Franklin was born in Boston, but he moved to Philadelphia. He already lived in Philadelphia at this point. And this rock, which was found, you know, while this person, John Winthrop, was going for a walk, looked unfamiliar to him. So he thought it was something different. And of course, he sent it to a museum to get analyzed. And he named it Columbian. And I guess this is news to me, actually. Columbia was the poetical name for the United States. Is that known to all Americans? All right, you're learning something. So, anyways, the rock sat in the British Museum for 60 years, you know, so that shows you how quickly they jumped on it. And here is a famous paper, which you can get a copy of, and I love the title, An Analysis of a Mineral Substance from North America Containing a Metal Hitherto Unknown. So they didn't know what it was. It was being called Columbian at that point. Anyways, this analysis says it was new. This work in 1801 was disputed in 1809 by the English chemist William Hyde Wollaston, and he said there was just one mineral. There was a mistake. And so it was not Columbian, it was actually something that was already known, tantalum. A little while later, everything's 50 years here. Another 50 years went by, and it was disputed in 1846 by the German chemist Heinrich Rose, who argued that there were actually two additional elements in that rock, and he thought there was some tantalum, and then he named the other two elements after the children of Tantalus. One child was niobium, or from Niobe, and the other was Pelopium from Pelops. By the way, there's a mountain in British Columbia called Mount Niobe, just a random fact thrown out there. All right, but the main thing is that Tantalus had two children, and there was three elements in this rock at this time. All right, so let's learn about Niobe in Greek mythology. So Niobe was the daughter of Tantalus. Niobe had 14 children, seven boys and seven girls. And due to hubris, which my wife tells me is a character flaw, Leto had Artemis and Apollo. So this is the, Leto had children with Zeus. And these are the two children. And this is the boy and this is the girl. And Apollo was asked to kill all the boys, and Artemis was asked to kill all the girls. You know, Greek tragedy, everybody's got to go in the end. This depressed the mother after her 14 children were killed, and she ran away and turned into a stone, another stone. There she is there in this famous picture. And as I say, she doesn't look like she's working hard enough to protect her children. You know, just putting her hand up, I would have expected more from my mother. All right, so here's a mountain. It's called the Weeping Rock. And this is associated, you see a face here. It's associated with Niobe's legend. So quite a story behind Niobe. So niobium it is, well, but sometimes Columbian. So the last paper published by American Chemical Society with Columbian in its title dates from 1953, not that long ago. While niobium was used in Europe, the name niobium was chosen for element 41 at the 15th conference of the Union of Chemistry in Amsterdam in 49. A year later, this name was officially adopted by IUPAC, as we call it, after 100 years of controversy. But the U.S. Geological Survey still prefers the name Columbian. Gotta stick to your guns here. We call it niobium at Fermilab, just for your, and just so you know, there you go. That's solid niobium. This is a superconducting radio frequency cavity, which we are building our new accelerator out of here, many of these. And I just find it amazing there's such a history to this. So this, you can see the color similar to that rock I showed you. I don't know if that's meaningful or not. Here is those cavities go inside of a big cryomodule. There's a person for scale, and we put eight of these cavities in here, and it's used to accelerate particles. So that's the future being used with stones. Now, every talk should have a quote from Einstein. One cannot help but be in awe contemplating the mysteries of eternity, of life, and of the marvelous structure of superconducting RF cavities at Fermilab made with pure niobium. All right. You can see I'm a serious person. So, all right, onward to physics. And now the talk gets more complicated as I go here. So I'm going to talk about the wide range, why the wide range of quark masses is puzzling. The top quark discovery was an exclamation mark on that. And the ultra-tiny neutrino mass doesn't fit into the standard model. So that's basically what I'm telling you is quark masses are all over the map, and the neutrino mass looks like it doesn't fit. Now, you know the whole story of the Higgs. The Higgs has brought together flavor and mass, and I'll define flavor in a second. And this is kind of a complicated story, but it's an ongoing story, so we're trying to learn. So one future, lies in better understanding of neutrinos. So you're going to hear me talk about neutrinos all the time. If you come back, I'll be talking about neutrinos. That's our new favorite particle here. Their mass ordering, which means there's three neutrinos, is which one's heavier? The origin of the mass, where does it come from? Well, you all should know it comes from the Higgs mechanism. Not true, maybe. Why are they so small? Don't know. What about their interactions? Are neutrinos different from antineutrinos? Don't know. Relationship to the antimatter-matter asymmetry in the universe? Maybe. Related to the structure of the universe? Yes. All right. So back to Isaac Newton. How do we define mass? Well, the mass I'm talking about is just what you think. It's the property of a body that is a measure of its inertia, and that is commonly taken as a measure of the amount of matter. Sounds like it was written by Newton, actually. It contains and causes it to have weight in a gravitational field. So for the aficionados, I don't want you to think that mass is the only story when it comes to gravity. It's not. Gravity really likes to see energy. But if things are moving slow enough, then Newton got it right. All right, so what gives mass to the proton? So the proton on the scale of particles is very big. The neutron is big, the proton is big, and it's full of stuff inside of it. Now, you know, the simplest drawing is that you draw three quarks inside of the proton, up, up, down, and these little wiggly lines are the gluons that hold it together, and that's what we think it is. Now, the bottom is important here. The proton is a composite particle. It's not an elementary particle. And the question is, where does its mass come from? Well, it's all this junk in here, you can see. There's the gluons. These are called C quarks, special type of quark. There's the one quark, there's the other quark, and there's the other quark. So the three I drew here, the simple drawing, actually is buried in something much more complicated. And the mass of the proton doesn't really come from these three quarks. The gluons are massless, so they don't count. And they don't really come from these tiny masses. It comes from the energy associated with these things inside. So if you know from Einstein equals mc squared, energy is mass. So most of the mass of the proton is coming from energy. And that theme will come back a little later. So we know what gives mass to the proton. What gives mass to the quarks and the leptons? So first of all, there are quarks and there are leptons. And this is what we call matter particles, all of these things. The world is made out of up quarks and down quarks and electrons. So up, up, down was a proton. Add an electron, you got a hydrogen atom. Then there's the three neutrinos, the neutrino associated with the electron, the muon, and the tau. Then there's the forces. We talk about the four forces. So there's gravity, not shown. Then there's the strong force, the electromagnetic force, and the weak forces. And the Higgs is the particle that, as you know, has been recently discovered. And it's the Higgs that gives the mass to the quarks. And we think it gives mass to the leptons. But we're not sure if it gives mass to the neutrinos. So that's the big question. OK, we sometimes call this the flavor problem. But this slide illustrates the issue. So up, down, neutrino, electron. These little balls are telling you the area of the ball is proportional to the mass. So you can see the up is fairly small, down is fairly small, neutrino's tiny, and we know the electron is fairly light. No surprise there. But then you go to the second generation, or the second family, if you like. The charm quark's quite heavy, so it's a big ball. Strange quark is pretty big. Neutrino's still tiny. So you're starting to ask, you should be asking yourself now, does it really fit? Does the neutrino really fit in this picture? because this one got bigger, this got bigger, and this got bigger, but I'm not sure what happened here. So let's go to the third generation. Whoa, there's the top. Top is ridiculous, as you know. Bottom, tau, neutrino. So big, bigger, biggest. Big, bigger, bigger. Big, bigger, bigger, but not sure about the neutrino. So there's something fishy about the neutrinos. All right, so I'll just remind you, because I am the director of Fermilab, the top quark was discovered at Fermilab by the CDF experiment, and I'm required to say the D0 experiment, because I worked on the CDF experiment. I can hear the D0 people in the audience. I love the D0 experiment. All right. So here are all the happy physicists at their press conference, and these are all the Italian newspapers that were very excited by the news. All right, so now let's talk about quark masses and the Higgs field. So Weinberg and Salam realized that a Higgs field can give mass to charged quarks and leptons at the same time as giving mass to the W and Z. So the whole idea of their theory was to understand how to give the W and Z mass, but eventually they figured out that it could give the quarks masses and the leptons masses. And the question is, do the neutrinos fall into that category? The quark masses are proportional to how strongly each quark couples to the Higgs field. So we're going to talk about a field as something which permeates all space, and the particles are coupling to those. There's Mr. Higgs. All right, quarks mix. So the forces carried by the, so remember these are the force particles, Z boson, photon, gluons, do not change the flavor of a quark. So what's a flavor again? Up is a flavor, down is a flavor, top is a flavor, bottom is a flavor, charm is a flavor. And we use the same words with the electron, with the leptons. So electrons a flavor, muons a flavor. So these ones don't change the flavor, but the W boson, this is the charged one, carries electric charge, and so changes both the charge and the flavor of a quark, for example, converting an up quark to a down quark. And that's what this picture is here. This is the famous neutron decaying. So a neutron, it's very similar to a proton, except it's got two down quarks, up, down, down. And you can see this down quark eventually changes into an up quark. So that's what I'm referring to. So this quark can change into that quark. So a quark, but the mechanism that gives mass to quarks does not respect flavor. So we now know the mechanism is the Higgs mechanism. And somehow the Higgs is mixing everything up together, and I'm going to come back to that. So a quark with a definite mass is a quantum mechanical mixture of different flavors. So, and the reverse is true. So if I have a down quark of a particular flavor, it's actually a combination of different masses. Or I could say something with a single mass is a combination of flavors. So if you were constructing the world in any sensible way, you wouldn't do that. It just complicates things. But that's coming about from the Higgs mechanism and the way it works. So quark mixing leads also to matter-antimatter oscillations. So this is just a phenomena that comes about. So quark mixing also implies that some of the neutral mesons, namely the K0, the two B mesons, are mixtures of flavor. And this can be interpreted as the neutral meson oscillating in time between itself and its antiparticle. So the way I think about this drawing is you start off with a B, and eventually it changes into, say, an S. And down here, it starts off as an S and eventually changes into a B. I know that a B and an S gives me a B0 sub S, and you notice that's a particle, and the bar tells you it's an antiparticle. So what's happening is this moves back and forth. So you have a B, goes to a B bar goes back to a B and is oscillating in time. So there was a well-publicized measurement, shall I say, matter-antimatter oscillations that were discovered by CDF and D0. The point I want to make here is that the oscillation frequency was 3 trillion times a second. So the matter is oscillating into antimatter and back, and that frequency is 3 trillion times. So that's pretty fast. All right, so let's get more sophisticated. CP symmetry. So Dirac onwards, physicists assume that nature does not have separate rules for particles and antiparticles. They were just thought to have all the same equations describing them. Now, C consists of the letter C and P, and the C means something. It refers to charge conjugation, which is changing the sign of the electric charges. And P is parity, which changes the handedness of a particle. And the handedness is the orientation of its spin compared to its motion. The combination of CP interchanges a left-handed electron with its antiparticle, a right-handed positron, and that's what that picture is telling you. So you can see in this picture, the electron is spinning one way, and the positron is spinning the other way. The electron has a negative charge, and the positron has a positive charge. So if everything was okay, the equations describing this should work for the equations describing that. That's basically what it means. That turned out not to be true, so I'm going to tell you again. There's the quark sector, and there's the lepton sector. So we've now observed CP violation at this point in 1964 in the quark sector by Jim Cronin and Val Fitch that showed the neutral K meson oscillations have a small asymmetry. So the way I think about it is the particle is oscillating into the antiparticle, and the antiparticle is oscillating back into the particle. If the rate that it goes one way is different than the rate it goes the other way, they're different, and so that's CP violation. Jim Cronin looks very surprised. He's got the Nobel Prize here, but he certainly deserved it. Direct violation of CP symmetry in kaon decays was discovered at Fermilab in 1999 with the KTAV experiment. So that was the icing on the cake for that whole discussion. Now we talk about CP violation mixing and the Higgs. So these two scientists, Kobayashi and Moskawa, showed there is one physical phase parameter in the CKM matrix. You don't have to understand that. The point is that there was a theoretical description of how the quarks were mixing and the fact that they weren't mixing the same in different directions. In that, other words, the antimatter was behaving different from the matter. And they were able to describe it with this matrix. And the value of this phase, which shows up in a number of places, was 67 degrees. So there is a number. It's a pretty big number. And it's saying, yes, matter behaves quite differently from antimatter. So people were very excited about this description. And they did this work before they knew that there was six quarks, which is more impressive. At the time, there was only four quarks. Matter and antimatter asymmetry in the universe. So that's one of the reasons we're interested in this. So the CP violation observed in the quark sector is too small to explain the asymmetry in the universe. So the whole point of studying this, at least one of the main points, is to try and explain why our universe is made out of matter and not equal amounts of matter and antimatter. But it turns out, although it was thought originally this might be the case, it's not enough. There must be something else. So there's another idea out there called leptogenesis. It's a theory that says leptons may play a role. Remember, neutrinos are leptons. Neutrinos are candidates for this. For the aficionados, you can go and see Boris Kaiser's lecture on this, which is superb. The Higgs was discovered. And the Higgs got the Nobel Prize. And I was reading this earlier. This is a colleague of ours. He missed his daughter. I don't know how that got on there, but I guess, you know, if you get a Nobel Prize, you're willing to spend some time away. So this was the first time that the entire New York Times science section is devoted to a single story. So it is a big deal. And a billion people watched the results of this. So it was... It is the big discovery. The CMS detector at CERN, which Fermilab is involved in, the U.S. is involved in, is just a big tool. It's answering questions. So it's no different from the simpler tools I showed you earlier, other than this is more complicated. The U.S. played a leading role in the LHC Higgs discovery, as you probably know. And if you don't know, I'm going to tell you. The U.S. is 33% of CMS, which is the largest national contingent, 23% of ATLAS. So, you know, I just say on average it's about a quarter of the experiment. So this is a big effort by the U.S. in terms of contributions to the Large Hadron Collider. You see some of the people here you may recognize. This is the University of Michigan group. I don't know why they got so much press, but I'm sure they deserved it. Thousands of scientists were involved, almost 100 universities, many national labs, a lot of states. Okay, so the recent observation of the Higgs boson at CERN is a discovery of the century. That's a quote from myself. It's true. And it was early in the century, so I've really got my neck out on that one. Interacting with the Higgs field is how elementary particles acquire mass. So you're being told this over and over again. This is how particles get mass. And the Higgs boson is the particle associated with the Higgs field, which is how the particles are interacting. And mass, by the way, is highly concentrated energy, so equals mc squared. You all understand that formula. Will we ever make practical use of the Higgs discovery in the coming decades? You know, everybody asks these questions. What's it good for? What's the Higgs good for? Well, will the Higgs boson become a tool? That's the obvious question, right? It's a particle. Any thoughts? Yes, very good. I'm impressed. You probably read the book, but okay. So, energy storage. Mass is the densest form of stored energy. What a great battery. Now, have I used all the words in my title, front row?
Yes.
Yes, very good. Understanding the physics of how nature stores energy and mass is the ultimate goal. Can the Higgs field be turned on and off? This would transfer kinetic energy to potential energy and vice versa. Remember, Ben Franklin discovered the battery. Manipulation would be the next step. You're not sure whether I'm serious, right? So that's the fun part. Okay, Higgs and the mysteries of mass. So there's two types of mass I'm going to mention. One is called Dirac, after Dirac himself. The discovery of the Higgs boson verifies the Higgs mechanism of generating mass for the W and the Z, which is what it was there for. But also, Yukawa couplings of the Higgs fields to the quarks and charged leptons can give them masses proportional to the vacuum value of the Higgs field. A little complicated, but let's just look at this formula, because that simplifies everything for you. So this letter Y is named after the famous Japanese physicist Yukawa. And for the top quark, it's basically 1. So just think of this number as 1. This is related to this number, so it's another number. And what this is telling you is E stands for electron, and L stands for left, and R stands for right. And what this is telling you is that the Higgs field is converting the left-handed electron into a right-handed electron. Now, how many of you are left-handed? Quite a few. One would hope all the theoretical physicists are left-handed. They always like to tell you that. So, all right, so left-handed, we're just going to think of it as left-handed, and right-handed, we're just going to think of it as right-handed. You know that the left-handed mitt does not fit on your right hand. They are different. They're different particles. But when the Higgs field is around, it kind of behaves like the same particle. So the Higgs mechanism, so how does it work? How does it give mass to the particle? So this is due to Joe Licken, which I think is here somewhere. So if it's wrong, talk to Joe afterwards. So here is the spin of the particle. So this is this arrow represents it spinning one way or it's spinning the other way. And the projection of the spin on the direction of motion is what we're referring to as handedness. And the R stands for right-handed. So this axis is space. This axis is time. So this set of arrows is something that's not really, on average, going anywhere, except time is going forward. And you see it changes from a right-handed to a left-handed by changing its direction of motion. And so what's happening here is it's interacting with the Higgs field. So think of the Higgs field as just everywhere. And this particle on a very high frequency is doing this, interacts with the Higgs field. Think of it as changing its direction, if you like. And the effect of changing its direction is turning it from right-handed to left-handed. Now, you remember what I said about the proton's mass. The proton's mass was largely coming from motion. And what I'm telling you here is the concept of mass in the Higgs mechanism is largely coming from motion. So you've got a left-handed electron, you've got a right-handed electron, and they're oscillating back and forth. Now, it's an abstract idea, but I think it gives you some sense of what's going on. So I say it in words here. A right-handed electron, by interacting with the Higgs field, becomes a left-handed electron and then back again. So what is the frequency? Well, it's an extremely high frequency, and this flipping has intrinsic energy, which is the mass of the electron, so E equals mc squared. The top quark, because it's heavier, would be flipping a lot faster. So that's the basic idea. So let's talk about neutrinos a little bit. What is a neutrino? Well, it stands for the little neutral one, so it's a neutral lepton, and at the bottom here I say it's the only lepton that is electrically neutral. So Franklin would know what that means. The existence of the neutrino was postulated back in the 1930s. It's an elementary particle. So when I say elementary, I mean it has no structure that you can measure. So somehow it's infinitesimally small. It has no electric charge. It travels at nearly the speed of light, and I'm saying that because it's got a little bit of mass. And it passes through ordinary matter with virtually no interaction. So I'm going to tell you that the first neutrino was discovered at the Savannah River Nuclear Reactor in the 50s. Rhinus got the Nobel Prize for that. The second neutrino comes from our friend Leon Letterman, which was discovered at Brookhaven in the 60s. The third neutrino was found at Fermilab by these attractive people standing in front of Wilson Hall. What I'd like to say at this point is, if you look at the third generation, the top quark was discovered at Fermilab, the bottom quark was discovered at Fermilab, the tau neutrino was first observed at Fermilab, and we won't say where the tau was found. That was found at the other lab. All right, so now we're into the 1970s. So this is an experiment that was done by Ray Davis, who was in the office next to me at the University of Pennsylvania. So the sun produces electron neutrinos, and they're striking this atom, and out comes an electron and an argon atom. Here's his detector. His detector was about 1 mile underground in this mine in South Dakota, which I'm going to come back to later on. It's called the Homestake Mine. It's dry cleaning fluid in here, so it wasn't too sophisticated, but believe me, at this time, this was a big deal, putting an experiment a mile underground to try and detect particles from the sun, which people really weren't sure what that was all about. This mine, by the way, is a gold mine, and this is where the Hearst Foundation made all their money, for those of you who enjoy history. So this turned out to be the first evidence for neutrino mixing, but at the time, here's the error bar of the data coming across. There's the sum of it. This is combined for many years. It's tiny, tiny measurement. He's saying that's how many neutrinos I'm seeing. These are years here. So each year, Ray would open his drawer. I saw him do this. Take a pencil out, put a point on his graph, put the paper back in his drawer, and he never published it. He did this because he loved doing it. This is what John Bacall, his partner in crime, if you like, was the theorist behind the story, was an expert in the solar model. And it was thought at the time that we really understood how the sun worked, and the number of neutrinos coming out of the sun should have been something we could predict. And you could see a discrepancy. And for many, many years, people just did not believe, I guess, at least I didn't, having seen him put that point on the paper. I wasn't so sure this was very sophisticated, but in fact it was. Anyways, Ray got the Nobel Prize for this in the end, because of course he was right. But in the meantime, and new era for neutrino physics with Super K discovered neutrino mixing in 1998. This is this detector in Japan, 50,000 tons. You've perhaps seen this picture. with this, these are people in a little dinghy, and this is the detector. It's absolutely huge. The Blue Man Group discovers solar neutrinos. That's a Chicago joke, right? All right, so this is the snow experiment in Sudbury, Canada. Raises new questions. So this is 2001 now, so this is a beautiful experiment. And so there was new questions raised after this. So this absolutely settled the issue that it wasn't the wrong number of neutrinos coming out the sun, because this experiment was able to see the total number of neutrinos, and it was able to see the electron neutrinos, which is what Ray Davis was looking for. And they could see the deficit in electron neutrinos, but the total was correct. So you nailed it. The original model of the solar model of John Bacall was correct. And the interpretation now is that one neutrino, the electron neutrino, changed into the other type of neutrinos on its path from the sun to the Earth. So neutrinos really are different. They're difficult to study because they interact with only ordinary matter, only through weak interactions. They can travel through a light year of lead without any trouble. They have their own mixing. So now, you know, I talked about the quark mixing before, and now we're going to see that there's mixing in neutrinos. And the question is that the same thing? So we know the quark mixing is due to the Higgs, but is the neutrino mixing due to the Higgs? And there we don't know. I gave you a number earlier about the mixing of the quark. It was 3 trillion times a second, if you remember. The neutrinos oscillate a billion times slower. So they're not mixing all that fast. Maybe not surprising, I don't know. 100 billion neutrinos are passing through your thumbnail as you sit there now. That's a lot. And where are they coming from? Sun. They're coming from the sun. Where else would they come from? All right, so they're coming from the sun, and there's a huge flux, but of course they don't interact. They just go through you. They go through the Earth. There's also neutrinos that are created after the Big Bang, which are called relic neutrinos, and that's an experimental challenge. Has never been observed, and people don't actually know how to find them, though there's some ideas. And there are more neutrinos than any other matter particle, so there's lots of them. So we get neutrinos from the sun. We get neutrinos from cosmic rays. Yeah, you get positrons and neutrinos from bananas and nuclear reactors. So physicists like to do experiments next to nuclear reactors looking for neutrinos. And stars exploding. So there's a whole story here of how neutrinos are used to create the heavy elements. Now, people can make beams of neutrinos, which is truly amazing. When you think about 1950 was the first time they were able to even observe neutrinos, and it took forever to do that. Now we make neutrinos, and I'm not going to go into the details, but we do that here at Fermilab. We do it better than any other laboratory in the world. But we make one type of neutrino beam, so it's the muon neutrino beam. Perhaps seen this picture before. There's the high rise. And this is the tunnel pointing down, heading to Minnesota, where the neutrinos are going to emerge and be detected. So this is what we're making here at Fermilab, is the muon neutrino. Not this one and not this one. So I like this picture because it makes it real clear where the beam's going. I don't know how wide it is. I was told it was really wide. But the people from Minnesota don't seem to care, so that's really, really encouraging. So this is often referred to as building a ship in a bottle, because you have to build these humongous detectors way down underneath the ground. And so that's one of the challenges. This is our latest one. So this is called NOVA. You've perhaps heard about it. Look how big it is. This is a group of happy people that I think believe they're finished. They're not quite finished. And so this is the physics plot, which NOVA would like to clean up. So I've told you about solar neutrinos. I told you about Super K. They made their measurement with neutrinos coming from the atmosphere. And what everybody measures is the difference between, the mass difference between a couple of these lines here. So this is, think of this as the three neutrinos, M1 squared, M2 squared, M3 squared. And we measure this difference and we measure this difference. What we don't know is whether this is really the heaviest one or the lightest one. So it could be this picture. My green's going to run out. Or it could be this picture. So NOVA, the purpose of NOVA is to tell us the difference. This also illustrates rather well what I mean by mixing the masses and mixing the flavors. So this particular mass has some red, green, and blue, which refers to the three types of flavors. So the concept of flavor and mass is mixed in particle physics. It's a little confusing to think about, but it's nevertheless very important. Neutrino and quark mixing and masses are different, so this matrix of numbers is telling you something about the mixing of the neutrinos, and this one is telling you about the mixing of the quarks. This is the one where the Nobel Prize was given, except it's numbers now, it's not equations. Compare this number in this corner with this number. You can see there's a huge difference. This looks somewhat similar. The diagonal looks a little similar. But the edges are really quite different. And so the question is, why are they so different? Well, you saw the masses were different, so I mentioned the masses here. Neutrino masses are thought to be less than 2 electron volts, at least. Quark masses, look how big that number is. That's the top. It's the heaviest. So they're just obviously very different. So they're different in their masses, and they're different in the way they mix. So we're not sure why, but we're pretty sure it's important to understand that. Some more formulas to help you out. How does the Higgs talk to neutrinos? So remember I described this with electrons before. So here's the so-called Yukawa coupling. And if we assume that neutrinos get their mass in the same way that the electron gets the mass, then you would just write this formula down, and all I've done is change E to nu, and everything else is the same. However, there's two problems. One is the nu right. The right-handed neutrino doesn't exist, so we would have to find it. So that's one problem. And the second one is physicists like this number to be 1, and for neutrinos it has to be tiny. So if you're not a physicist, maybe that doesn't bother you. But if you're a physicist, you like numbers that are close to 1 for some reason. Physicists understand that. All right, so that would be the analogy to what we call the Dirac mass. There's another type of mass which is referred to the Majorana mass. And this, you can write an equation that looks like this. But now the Majorana mass says the neutrino is its own antiparticle. So the antineutrino is the same as the neutrino. This is a concept that's possible because the neutrino is neutral. So that's a whole new idea. It's got physicists excited about whether that's a real possibility. But either way, this type of mass is different from the type of mass I told you before. So you can see this is the left and right going back and forth again. So it, because it's so light, it wouldn't be going so fast. But it's the left-handed neutrino turning into a right-handed neutrino and back. But this type of mass is assumed to be different from that. So there's a whole other type of mass out there that we'd be interested in finding, but that takes time. So what's next beyond NOVA? NOVA is the big new experiment. We're back to South Dakota. Returning to the scene of the crime. Here is a picture for those of you who want to drive out there. It's a very nice drive. You can see this is Lead, South Dakota is the town. All right, the goal. So just remember this name, Long Baseline Neutrino Experiment, LBNE. The neutrino-antineutrino beams provide important clues to understanding the overall symmetry of matter versus antimatter in our universe. So I told you that we wanted to understand where all the antimatter went. We thought we had the answer when we saw a CP violation in the quark sector. In other words, quarks are different from antiquarks. It isn't enough. And so the next thing we're trying to understand is, could it possibly be the neutrinos? And if so, is the antineutrino different from the neutrino? That's the main purpose of this experiment. It's an important question. Neutrino astronomy is another subject that can be studied at the same time. So we're going to take this detector, and I'll show you it's going to be a mile underground, same level as the original Ray Davis experiment. But his experiment was relatively small. It looked big in the picture, but compared to what we plan to build, it's relatively small. So when a star explodes, that's what a supernova means, the neutrinos are the first to leave. So you probably know the story of 1987A. It's a very famous explosion that was observed. And the neutrinos were detected in a number of experiments around the world, in Japan, the US, and in Europe. And they found that the explosion of the star created a burst of neutrinos in their detectors of about 10 in 10 seconds. Now, typically, they got about one per day. So 10 in 10 seconds was, whew, rush hour of neutrinos. And you could learn a lot from that, because that was telling you the details of the inner workings of the star as it exploded. The light showed up, I forget, the next day, you know, because the light scatters around, takes a long time to get out. So that's what's kind of cool about seeing the neutrinos first. In the experiment LB&E, rather than finding 10, we're expecting to find 10,000. So you will get a lot of information about that star exploding. The only caveat is the star has to explode. So that's, we've tried to explain that to the government. But that's a challenge. And then I'll just mention proton decay is another important thing. So we're going to go straight through the Earth. You know the story. So it's 800 miles, 1,300 kilometers if you come from Canada. And you end up here. The detector is humongous, 50,000 tons of liquid argon a mile underground. So now you ask yourself, how much is 50,000 tons? So I'll give you a sort of an estimate. If you fill your house, I'll assume I know how big your house is. If we take a typical Batavia, Illinois house and fill it with liquid argon, that's about 50 tons. So you would need 1,000 houses filled with liquid argon a mile underground to detect the neutrinos from the beam, from Fermilab. And I told you there was 100 billion going through your thumbnail. We can make beams that are 100 times more powerful than the sun. So the technology of making neutrino beams has progressed a long way. All right, again, we like the Google Maps. So we start in Chicago. We go there. There's some concept of what the detector might look like. There's going to be a near detector here at Fermilab. There's got to be a beam line that's made, and then this will be the challenge. There's a blow-up of it. Pretty nice-looking detector, 50,000 tons. Notice we say the actual detector may look different than this, but that's like the small print. It goes a mile underground, actually 4850 level. And we think of putting it over here. I've been down in this mine. It's okay. The technology for detecting neutrinos, liquid argon is really kind of pushing the envelope. So all of the experiments I told you before that looked for neutrinos used water. The Japanese experiments used water. The experiments in the US used water. The experiments in Europe. But the Canadians used heavy water, because of their type of reactor, so they have a lot of heavy water. But this is quite different. It's cryogenic. You can see it runs at 87 degrees K, but you get very beautiful pictures, very detailed pictures of what's happening in these events. And so I think it's a good thing. You should always be pushing technology. If you push technology, that's your tool that you're developing to try and answer the question, and something will come out of this which is useful. That's the whole idea. I want to finish with just a couple of simple comments here. So you had a great talk by John Carlstrom. The merging of particle physics and cosmology is one of the great intellectual achievements of the past 50 years. Must be correct statement. It comes from The Economist. And I like their title, Man Suddenly Sees the Star of the Universe. All right, so you know about the cosmic microwave background. I just want you to know that niobium was used in the South Pole telescope. How coincidental is that? Can you believe that? They're shaking their heads in the front row here. This cannot be true. The purpose of me telling you this is we want to measure the mass of the neutrinos. I've told you that, and we're very interested in that number. And this experiment, the next generation of this experiment, should it be built, will allow us to make a very, very precise measurement of the neutrino masses, which is truly amazing, because you're looking at light scattered from the early universe. You're actually looking at the polarization of the light and how it's distorted by the gravitational field. And from that, you're able to deduce the neutrino mass. So this last picture, I think it's my last slide, neutrinos matter to the energy budget. So in this picture, you're looking at zero neutrino mass, and in this picture, 1.5 electron volts. That's a small number, because the electron is 500,000 electron volts. So this is really a tiny mass. But what I say here is the simulated maps of the gravitational potential that will be made by observing the distortions produced by gravitational lensing of the cosmic microwave background. So just look at this piece here compared to this piece here. You see dark spots here. So this is the depth of the gravitational potential. And it's the gravitational potential where matter falls in, the dark matter falls in, and that's the beginning of the galaxy formation, if you like. But you don't see it over here. The fact that you don't see it is because the neutrinos are moving almost at the speed of light, so they spread out. They don't collect. They don't collect together like dark matter. And so you see a smoothing out of this gravitational potential. And it's that smoothing out that you can use to determine what is the mass of the neutrinos. So let me end with a quote from our friend Ben. The rapid progress true science now makes occasions my regretting sometimes that I was born so soon. It is impossible to imagine the height to which may be carried in 1,000 years the power of man over matter we may perhaps learn to deprive large masses of their gravity and give them absolute levity for the sake of easy transport. So what he's saying is he was probably having to pick something heavy up, is my guess. And you noticed this is a young Ben Franklin. In later years, he looked a little less, fit. And so he's saying to himself, if I could just turn off gravity, it would be so much easier to move this table somewhere else. What he did not, it's an interesting concept that he thought of that, but why didn't he think of just turning off the Higgs field? He could have made. So he's not as smart as you think, Anyways, he is the consummate practitioner, and he wants to turn off gravity, so I was impressed with that. All right, thanks very much.
So we have time for about 10 minutes worth of questions. Please put your hand up, and people with mics will be coming to you. They'll be alternating from side to side. Good job.
Should I ask a question next?
You can go ahead and ask.
Okay. So if neutrinos are their own antiparticle, why don't they annihilate each other when they touch each other? Isn't that kind of what happens when matter and antimatter touch?
Excellent question. I agree with you. So the answer is yes, sort of. There's an experiment that everybody wants to do and to tell. So if neutrinos were their own antiparticles, then there's a famous experiment, which by the time it runs, you'll be able to be on it, is called neutrinoless double beta decay. So it's an experiment that under normal circumstances sees two electrons coming out and two neutrinos. And the fact that the neutrinos come out, you don't see them, but the electrons have different energy depending on how it's distributed between the neutrinos and the electrons. In neutrino-less double beta decay, and in this, in the, what I'll call the Majorana case, where you're, what you're talking about, they can annihilate one another, and the energy of the electron is fixed. And so we all want to be able to see that in an experiment. We don't know whether we can, but that's one of the big big questions in the field. So excellent question.
I was reading with interest an earlier edition this month of the daily newsletter from Fermilab that I get emailed, and I was wondering, how is the digging project coming?
The digging project, you got to tell me what that is.
I believe there was a picture of a number of staff members with shovels working on the neutrino project.
Ah.
And they were commenting how far it was to to the detector. I was just wondering how that's coming along.
Sounds like it's coming along great. I don't know.
My question, so with these, you know, you have these detectors 500, 800 miles away.
Yeah.
You really are just shooting them through the ground, what's there, right?
Yes.
You're not, there's not a wire, there's not
no.
a tube.
No.
Okay.
They go through my house, I'm told.
Oh, that's cool.
Ask my wife. Does she like that? No.
Well,
I'm not,
I don't know.
Not so sure.
Well, if they're already going through our thumbnail,
yeah,
then
what
I guess
the heck?
We're
just
not
a
supposed
few more.
To worry, right? A few
yeah.
more?
Yeah. No, it goes, that's the whole point. Is that the Earth is curved, right? As I showed you in that picture, and you can shoot them down, and so you got to line it up carefully because your detector's not infinitely big. That would be embarrassing. And you point it at the detector, and they just go through the Earth like nothing. So when I went to the South Dakota mine, and we were in the tunnel, and it was and the tunnel was small, and it was dirty, and it was dark, and there's just these rock walls. And I said to the guy from DOE, I said, do you really believe the neutrinos come all the way and get through this rock? I mean, would you build a huge experiment here without testing that first? You should have seen the look, like, oh my goodness. Well, they go through, it's okay, we're safe.
I have a question related. What do liquid argon, cleaning fluid, and water have in common that allows you to see neutrinos?
They have atoms in common. So the neutrinos will interact with the nucleus of those atoms. So the liquid argon is fairly big, and so it's a big nucleus. It's a big cross-section, as we say. So, you know, what really is the details of it is roughly speaking that those types of detectors allow us to detect the electrons that come out. They allow you to see a signal. So it's not so much the you have to have a lot of mass no matter what in a neutrino experiment. You could imagine it's rock would work well, but we can't instrument rock. So we want to be able to instrument. So it's a live detector in some sense. So water, you know, the neutrino comes in, strikes a nucleus, makes an electron, and then it's the electron that makes the signal in the water. It emits Cherenkov radiation, which is light, and then that's detected in the phototube. So that's what I call a live detector. Liquid argon is a similar idea.
If you can detect neutrinos from the Big Bang,
mm-hmm.
would you be able to see back further than the cosmic background radiation?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So it would tell you more about the Big Bang?
Yeah, I think it's 1 second. I think it's on my slide. I don't know if that's the right number, but it's, you know, the CMB is 380,000 years after. So, you know, the best information I would say we have is from the ratio of hydrogen to helium to lithium in the universe. So that's the period when nuclei first formed. And so that's 10 seconds or something like that. It's fairly early on. So we actually have some pretty good experimental evidence for going back that far. And then neutrinos would be even earlier. And then, of course, the gravitational waves that were just discovered are thought to be 10 to the minus 34 seconds, which is during the inflationary period. So you're starting to pepper that whole region with some experimental data now.
Is it on? Oh, yeah. Okay. Since you're the director here, are you worried about running out of helium? Because I heard that we were going to run out.
Yeah, so there is a helium shortage, and the price of helium is going up very fast. And so what we do here is we have what I would call a closed system. So in the old days, you would just let helium boil off as it got. So helium's used for cooling things and so on. It's important in magnets. And you could let it go, and you would just buy some more. But now it's always contained, so you reliquefy it, and you keep it in a closed system. So once you've got enough to do what you need, you're pretty much covered. But it is a non-renewable resource, and we have to pay attention to that. Good question.
You've raised the hope that one could use manipulation of the Higgs field to convert almost any kind of matter, I guess, into a battery. But a battery always requires something with which to charge the battery. So I'm just wondering whether you also entertain any hope that one could manipulate Higgs fields intensively enough, say, to create lots of tiny little black holes, perhaps, and use their evaporation as an energy supply.
That sounds like an upgrade to my idea. That's that's very good. So the one thing I'll say, I mean, obviously, you know, I actually talked about the Higgs battery to a collection of nuclear engineers, and I told them that was the future of nuclear energy. But if you think about annihilation, you're taking mass and you're converting it into energy. And so nature knows how to do this somehow. So I always think about the early universe where everything is moving at the speed of, by early I mean really early, prior to the Higgs field being created, everything's moving at the speed of light. Somehow nature figures out how to make all these little batteries of mass, made all the electrons, made all the quarks, and so on. So all I'm saying is, if we could figure out how to do that, then we're in business. We just manipulate that field. And I'm almost sure it's going to happen. I don't know how to do it, but we just haven't got sophisticated enough that we can manipulate space now. But at some point, I think that'll happen.
Do you think getting the energy supply rather than the battery is going to be more technically difficult? Because, you know, we have this issue, say, with hydrogen fuel cells for cars mm-hmm. and stuff. I mean, it's nice that we have new kinds of batteries nowadays and new ways to power our vehicles, but it doesn't answer the issue of where is our energy going to come from, so
that's
why I'm kind of thinking of the two in tandem. So which problem do you think is harder? That's what I
wonder. Well, you're right. There's two problems. There's the problem of just energy in general, and then there's energy that's kind of useful for your car or something like that. So if you think about nuclear fusion, which is, I think, where the planet is in some ways, this is the ITER project, is putting a lot of eggs in that basket, is in principle you can use something like hydrogen, or in that case deuterium and tritium, to be your fuel. And if you can make that work, then that's a huge amount of energy for foreseeable future, I would say. So that, you know, people are starting to think about what is the, and governments are spending a lot of money on it, including our government, on what is the long-term energy picture. But, you know, the most ambitious thing, I would say, is that project right now.
So I think we have time for one more question, and then after that, we're all invited to a reception upstairs, and Dr. Lockyer will answer a few more questions up there.
All right. So when, for, was it the NOVA experiment, when you're beaming tons of neutrinos through the Earth to the detector in Minnesota or wherever, how do you tell the difference between the neutrinos that came from Fermilab and just those, like, however many billion traveling through your fingernail every second?
That's a good question. It's actually easy, because the neutrinos are made with pulses of protons. So you have a fairly narrow timing window. I say easy conceptually. Actually, it's not that trivial to do it. But okay, so we make our neutrinos in pulses, very narrow timing pulses. And so we know how far it is to Minnesota. We know how fast they travel. We know where the detector is. That's what GPS tells you. And so we know when they should arrive. So you just check, was that the right one? Yes, it was. Very good. It's a little more sophisticated than that, but that's roughly it.
Okay, let's thank him again.